You may have seen the Create T3 Turbo and Clerk starter that Theo made a video on. A very short video. He barely showed you any of the code or how it works. And as the creator of that repo, I'm aiming to fix that. So let's take a deep dive into the T3 Turbo and Clerk starter. We're going to break this down in three different sections. First, Next.js. Then we're going to talk about tRPC. And finally, we're going to finish with Expo. So the Next.js code is found under Apps and Next.js. Once you click it, inside the source is where you're going to find all the important information. Let's start with the middleware. This middleware is for Clerk. This allows us to run auth checks in API routes or on the server side if you're using SSR or anything like that. What we're doing here is making sure that it doesn't run on static files, but does run on images and requests for tRPC, because those are obviously important. Next up, we need to talk about .env files. So when you use a .env, we have this server check here to make sure you're not exposing keys to the public. So if you're using a server key like a client secret, we don't want to put that out into the world. Again, with our client here, we want to make sure that we have the correct kind of keys. It should be next_public. If it doesn't have that, it will also throw an error message. And finally, in our schema here, this is where we set the keys that we require. So we do require a next_public clerk publishable key and a client secret. If those aren't included, you cannot run this application and it will throw an error message. That makes sure that you are set up for success. Moving on from environments, we need to now talk about pages. So in the pages, we have this sign in and sign up section. Both of these are just mounted components here from Clerk, and it tells us what the path is and the sign up URL. Same for the sign up here. We make it really easy to just add in these components, and whatever you put in the dashboard will show up on the screen. So if you add Google Auth, it will just show up. If you require a username or you require passwords or phone numbers, whatever it might be, it just automatically will be updated to the correct version. That is our two mounted components. And then we have our app.tsx. What we're doing here is wrapping the whole application in the Clerk provider. This Clerk provider allows us to access auth anywhere in our application alongside the middleware. So if you need to check on the client side if the user is authenticated, you can do that. Or you need to check in the tRPC routes, you can also do that when it's wrapped up in this Clerk provider. Talking of client-side code, let's talk about the page that a user sees. So by default, it is the section here. This is where we grab all the post data and show it as a card. And then we have this auth showcase, which is what handles whether to show the sign in or to show the user button and secret message. So let's look at this auth showcase. What this auth showcase is doing is checking to see if the user is signed in. So if they're signed in, and then grabbing this data if they are indeed signed in. And on top of that, we then say, if they're signed in, go ahead and show this secret message plus click the user button. And underneath that, we then show the user button component, which is very common in things like Google. When you click it, you can add more accounts or manage your account. That's what we show here. And if they're not signed in, we ask them to click the sign in button, which is just a next link that directs them right back to the sign-in. Just our API route here, which is just using the standard tRPC create next handler with the router from our API here, which is in a separate package, and then making sure that we're using it as expected. If you need cores, you need to enable it down here. That's Next.js. Now let's talk about how tRPC is working behind the scenes. Packages contains three folders. The most important are your DB and your API. The DB holds Prisma. If you need to update your schema, just go ahead and go to DB Prisma Schema Prisma and update the models as you require. The API holds all of tRPC. So we need to talk about really two things here. First, context, and then secondly, the middleware. So what context is doing is checking for a user using this getUser function. We're using the getAuth helper from Clerk, which allows you to access specific parts of the auth state. Then what we're doing is asking for the user from our users API, and then we're returning the full user object. And then obviously we're awaiting this function here, and then we're returning that to the create inner context. What's great about this is when you move to middleware, it gives you access to check to see if they have a user object. If not, they are unauthorized, protecting your routes. And you can extend this even further. Because we have access to the full user object, you actually have access to all these different things. For example, unsafe metadata, you could store a custom role in there. And if they have that custom role, maybe they're allowed to do admin type things. Inside our router, we have auth. So here we have just two routes. One is get session, which returns the full user object in a public procedure. And then we have this get secret message, which is a protected procedure. Then in our posts here, which is our other router, we have all, which is a public procedure that gets all the posts, by ID, get a specific post. And finally, this create. We'll talk about how that all works in a minute. Finally, we just export all of these out so that you can add and extend more routers as you need. And that is TRPC. So the final piece to this puzzle and the deep dive is Expo. Now, Expo was the trickiest part and why this template even came about. So first, we need to talk about this app.tsx. What you'll notice here is that we're actually providing the publishable key to the Clerk provider, unlike Next.js. And we also have this thing called a token cache. What a token cache does is make sure that the valid JWT is always available. You can see the token cache under utils cache, but it's a very basic using secure store from Expo Secure Store. We just save or get the token as required. Outside of that, this looks pretty familiar. Signed in means that the user has to be signed in to see these pages, and signed out, this is what they'll get, which is the sign in and sign up screen. This is where the true magic happens. This component called sign in with auth holds the key to how mobile authentication works. What we have here is a completely custom flow. Instead of using the components that you saw with Next.js, you get a different screen that looks like this. Just a single button that has sign in. When you click this sign in with Discord and you click continue here, you are presented with this Discord button, you click authorize, and then you're redirected into here, and then you can publish posts as you see fit. So if I say, hello, welcome, and hit publish, you'll see that this appears up here. So let's talk about how that sign-in flow works. First, we should talk about these helpers here. We have one called use sign-in, which allows you to sign in and set sessions, and of course, sign up is the opposite of this flow. It also contains set session and is loaded, but because of the way that we're handling this and we're using something called transfer, we only need to use sign up and then one is loaded and set session. The first thing we do is check to make sure that Clerk is loaded. If it's not, we return null. Then once that it has loaded, we give you this giant handle sign in with Discord press. And this is quite complicated, so I'm gonna break it down piece by piece. First, we create a redirect URL using auth session from Expo, and we set it to OAuth native callback so that we can grab any information that we need. So then we create this promise, which is a sign-in resource. We tell it what kind of strategy we're using. In our case, we're using Discord, and we set the redirect URL to the one we created here. We then look for this external verification redirect URL from the sign-in object. And if we don't have one of those, we immediately throw an error that there's something wrong with this OAuth flow. And this is probably a misconfiguration or something else. Then we create this constant called auth result. What we do here is we start an async auth session, which basically only allows you to create one auth session at a time. We set the auth URL to the external verification redirect URL and the redirect URL that we have. Then we check to see what the auth result is. So the user's going through and they're clicking all the buttons, they click continue or they sign into their account. If it's not successful, we throw an error message immediately. Now I wanna point out here, we have a bunch of different type error messages here that you could be handling. Things like dismiss or canceled, you could prompt the user to try again because for some reason they've decided not to sign in. But we wanted to keep this as simple as possible. So we're just saying if it's not successful, clearly there's an error. Once we have this, we go and get this rotating nonce from the redirect URL. And then we reload the sign in request. And if there's a created session ID here, so if we manage to create a session ID, we can then have the user sign in immediately. That means they've already had an account. Everything went as expected. Otherwise, if there isn't a session ID, maybe they are a first-time user. So then we do this quick check here, and if the status here is not transferable, we just tell them that there's an error message. Otherwise, we transfer the account to sign up. This means that we're going to create the user versus trying to have them log in. What we do here is set transfer to true. Now, transfer to true essentially says, we already know everything about this user. Don't send them back through the flow. Here is all their information. Go ahead and just create the account. Then we do the same thing that we did up here, which is sign in.reload with that rotating token. And we just get it from the auth result versus the original one because we've created this new signup flow. Then we set the session to the newly created session ID from the signup request, and the user is signed in. Then from there, we should talk about the home screen. When the user is signed in, they are allowed to create posts as you saw. And what we're doing here is using this TRPC create use mutation, and then we invalidate the posts so that we can fetch new ones. And that works just on a standard form. But what's happening here is slightly different than Next.js. Now, if you remember from Next.js, if we quickly take a look again, we didn't have to do anything with the batch link here. We just sent the request down and we were smart enough to be able to go and get auth from TRPC APIs. But because Expo doesn't have the same helpers, what we're doing here is actually sending down as part of TRPC this auth token. So what I'm doing here is getting the token, use auth, and then I'm sending that down as a header. And then our helpers in the TRPC API layer are smart enough to say, hey, this is a JWT token that we own. We should use that to get the user from the context. And then we can use the same flow. So we don't have to write any additional code. All we have to do is send down this token. And this token will always be fresh because of our token cache, as well as the way that useAuth works, which is to grab a token if it's expired. I hope this really helped you understand how the T3 Turbo and Clerk repo worked. If you made it all the way to the end of the video, YouTube's going to recommend you something here. Go ahead and click it. It's algorithm driven. I bet it'll be a banger. And of course, if you're not subscribed, click subscribe right here. I'll see you in the next one.